My name is Tai-Danae Bradley. I'm currently a postdoc at X, the Moonshot Factory, which you might know by its previous name, Google X. And prior to that, I finished a PhD at the CUNY Graduate Center in New York City. So no, I would not say that math always came naturally to me when I was younger. For me, math was just one of those things that the grown-up said you had to do with all of your other topics. So I would say actually, I was an A student because I could memorize the formulas that the teacher said to memorize, or I could regurgitate sort of the procedures that they would instruct us to do. You know, I could mimic things well. I would get A's, but memorizing, of course, is not the same thing as understanding. I didn't really even have any, you know, memories of doing fun mathematics, except for maybe like being frustrated at how sometimes I didn't understand what things were. So I guess in that sense, I'm a little bit unconventional in that I became a mathematician, and yet it's not a subject that I would say came naturally to me as a younger student. So I've always really been interested in science. I've thought for a long time science is really exciting, and by the time I got to college, I was also really interested in sports. And so I thought maybe I would have a career in the intersection of those two. But I didn't really have a major picked yet when I entered college, but I was playing basketball actually for my university. And I was taking sort of the prerequisites you needed to be on the science track. And so by default, I was taking a series of calculus courses. And there were three courses, Calc 1, 2, and 3. Now, I don't remember really what happened in Calc 1 and 2, but when I got to Calculus 3, I had a really phenomenal teacher who taught mathematics in a way I had never heard taught before. And he kept emphasizing this idea that I had never heard before. And that's the idea that one does not need to be a genius to do mathematics. And I had never heard anyone say that before. I had never heard anyone describe mathematics in a way that was so engaging and so full of these concepts rather than just formulas or procedures to memorize. So after Calculus 3, I declared physics as my major. But as I asked more and more fundamental questions, I realized it's really the mathematics that I love, that those ideas I learned back in Calc 3. So 2 years later, after I finished the physics curriculum, I realized, oh no, there's still so much more to learn. I have to now be a math major. So then I declared a math major. I'm in my early 20s at this point. You know, I stay on it and I finish that for 2 more years. And then I decide, this is just the tip of the iceberg. There's so much more to learn. And then I decide to go to graduate school from then. A lot of my research involves mathematics that's from a more modern area of math called category theory. And so one way that one might think of category theory is a little bit like Mad Libs. So I'm going to try to give an analogy and we'll see if this works. But you know, Mad Libs, they're these sort of outlines of a story and you can plug in different words. And depending on which words you put in, you sort of get a different story, but maybe the outline is all the same. So there's something like that in math where there's kind of a common outline or a common template. But if you sort of change some of the words or change some of the tools, maybe you get a different mathematical story, but the outline sort of feels the same. Well, it turns out in the 1940s that mathematicians began investigating a bridge between a more sophisticated version of algebra called group theory and a more sophisticated version of geometry called topology, and a more sophisticated bridge that connects them. And that bridge now is what we know as category theory. And it turns out that finding connections across the mathematical landscape is really interesting, and there are lots of them, not just between, you know, algebraic things and geometrical things, but other branches of math. And so category theory is actually a branch of math that explains the bridges we see among math, you know, among fields of math across the landscape. So sometimes you might hear category theory described as the mathematics of mathematics. So it turns out a lot of the work that I do connects with ideas in machine learning, which you can think of as a subfield of artificial intelligence. And in fact, how ideas from quantum physics actually can inform some tools that we're using in machine learning. And as a mathematician who really enjoys category theory, I sort of like to see these mathematical ideas or category theoretical ideas as I'm doing my work in this more applied field of machine intelligence. So a little bit interdisciplinary, but that's sort of my work in a nutshell. As I mentioned earlier, I didn't really have sort of natural math inclinations as a young student, and I even came into mathematics sort of midway through college. And so after I declared a math major, and even when I got into graduate school, you can imagine it was difficult personally to not compare or try not to compare myself with my more experienced classmates. And so I remember, for example, I took an algebra class the first semester of my first year of graduate school. And everything that I knew about group theory from college was covered in the first 3 weeks, right? But there's like 12 more weeks of the semester to go. And as I sort of sat in my chair all discouraged and looked around at my classmates, I was thinking, I had the feeling, hey, everyone else seems to be, you know, like this is a walk in the park for them. But I felt like I got hit with a ton of bricks. And so that certainly was a personal struggle of mine, sort of feeling that I was playing catch up. In a sense that I felt I had less experience. And so it's tempting to sort of want to compare yourself to others. And so that's something, that experience is something that I had very frequently in graduate school. But because of that, I had to learn through those experiences to really persevere and to not look, you know, to the left or right and see what other people are doing, but just to stay focused on my own work, to learn how to be persistent through those trials. But once I figured out what worked for me, I then became, you know, like I got in the groove and then I was able to catch up as soon as I stopped worrying about other people. And so that, you know, it was a struggle, but I'm actually kind of glad for my unconventional pathway because this sort of perseverance that I guess I worked on at that time now really informs the way that I work today. And so in that sense, you know, it all worked out great. So one of my proudest accomplishments, well, I'm very happy that I finished graduate school and finished my PhD. I'm glad about that. But also one project that I'm very proud about is a website that I have called Mathema. So in 2015, my first year of graduate school, I started a blog, which I really started as a tool to help me prepare for these things called qualifying exams, which you have to pass in a graduate program. And I did this to sort of help me transition from undergrad to graduate school, to sort of keep track of all of this constant influx of information. I would write these little expositions to myself. And eventually I started putting these little expositions online because I thought, oh, I guess other people are taking qualifying exams. Maybe they'll find this helpful as well. But now, you know, fast forward 5 years, my blog, I think, has reached a number of people in ways that I certainly did not expect and could not have imagined when I started it 5 years ago. And so it's really been wonderful for me to see that, you know, my sort of simple explanations are, you know, providing occasional aha moments for other people as well. So that's something that's really exciting for me. I had a number of people that were very instrumental in helping me get to where I am today. And the first that comes to mind is the teacher of my Calculus 3 class that I mentioned earlier. His name is Sheikh Mabou. I had never heard anyone teach math in that way. That was the class that really, I think, changed my sort of course trajectory or my career trajectory, what I wanted to do in life. When I declared a math major, I started working on an undergraduate research project with Brooke Fagan, who is a number theorist at CUNY. So I did a little bit of undergraduate research, and her mentorship was really helpful for helping me learn how to, you know, move from more textbook math to research kind of math. And also Brooke was very helpful with me learning how does the graduate school application process work? Like, I need letters of recommendation. Okay, and what else do I need? And which school should I look out for? So I didn't know anything about that. And Brooke was very super helpful and was really the one that put me on the pathway to success in that space. And moreover, once I got into graduate school, my PhD program, a couple years in, I think, she, Brooke Fagan, encouraged me to reach out to another professor at CUNY, John Turilla, who eventually became my dissertation advisor. And so John Turilla also has been a wonderful mentor to me, and he was extremely supportive of not only the research, he introduced me to the research that I do now, but extremely supportive of my work on Mathema, so the writing that I do. We ended up co-authoring a book together, so, you know, I like to write, he likes to write. We have a co-author, Tyler Bryson, who's another student of his, so we all got together and had a lot of fun writing this book. And so, you know, once John became my advisor, graduate school was just, every day was really fun, and the way he explains math is just incredible. And so these three people were really, I wouldn't be where I am today without them. So one piece of advice that I like to give to students, especially during difficult times, because math is hard and it can certainly be tempting to sort of measure your worth based on your performance, I would advise against that. And instead, I think it's helpful to remember the joy that you find in the subject and to, you know, reflect on those wonders in mathematics that drew you to it in the first place, instead of, looking at your classmates or looking at other people and saying, oh, they've done this, but I've only done this. Earlier, we talked about, you know, comparing yourself with other people, and that doesn't get you anywhere. Not helpful. I would advise against that. But instead, think about the joys in the mathematics and the things that drew you to it. Keep your eyes fixed on that, and also persevere and endure through some of those hard times. So that's certainly easier said than done, but that's something that I think has certainly helped me personally, is to work on persistence and endurance and to think about the things that really drew you into math in the first place.